We're going to take a little bit of a break from 1 Timothy 3 to see what about just for a couple of weeks, because as you remember earlier in the year, I was working through 6 weeks so we quite get to the end of that book. We were midway through chapter 3, and so for the next couple of weeks, we're going to take that up again and just complete the series in 2 Timothy 3. So please, if you have your Bibles this morning, please take it. Thank you. the young church in northern France, which he planted not too long earlier, not 4 years earlier, in the midst of great opposition and persecution. And his overarching focus in this letter is to grow these leaders' hope and their longing for the return of Christ, and that would give them hope even in their struggle and their culture, waiting well for the return of Jesus. In other words, the return of Christ is not the sun, distant from the sun, it is not the sun of our lives today. It's incredibly relevant. That speaks to how we live today. It gives us comfort, joy, and hope, and perseverance. The key focus in chapter 1 was to look at encouragement for these suffering saints to persevere. Chapter 3 was instruction on wrong timing of these types of events. But as we come into chapter 3, we see Paul changes again. And I guess that's one of the strongest points to bring correction and rebuke to some of the Christians in this church. In my last message, I covered verses 1 to 5, which I titled Pray While You're Waiting. In those verses, Paul sought the prayers of the saints for his gospel ministry, and he prayed for them on the basis of the faithfulness of Christ, that he would grant them strength for well-being and protection. Without the following verses, 6 to 15, his focus moves to correcting his wrong behaviors and not work. So in title 51, he says, work while you're waiting. That is, to be a church who are waiting well for the return of Christ. We should be a working church, working for the glory of God in the way he's called us to be. We notice in verse 11, the cause of Paul even writing this at all. He says, we hear that some among you walk in idleness, not busy at all, but busy at all. That is what motivated him. It's the thought that it came his way that people in this community are simply in economic and not working like they should, and they're living off others and relying on them for their needs. What he's got to do all of that is causing disruption among the saints because of rebellious and troublemakers. So Paul calls these a good portion of this chapter and correcting them. And not just them, as I said earlier, the whole church and how they are controlled and dealing with this person. These verses are instructive not just on what God thinks about work and our responsibility to work, but also on how we do sin together as a church family. And we'll see that again next week. Well, I want us to see that this is 6 to 15 that Paul lays out for us 6 responsibilities for the church regarding waiting saints. 6 responsibilities. So that we work diligently as we wait for the church. 6 responsibilities we have to have if there are people in our church who are not following God's call to be working, refusing to work for one another. And today we're going to cover just the first 4. Next week. Well, the first responsibility we see is to separate them from the idol. We see this in verse 6. If you step back a few verses to verse 4, Paul there anticipates the correction that he's about to bring. He clearly senses how sure he is that when he commands them something, it's because he's going to listen, he's going to follow his directions. Verse 4, if we have confidence in the Lord upon you, that you are doing and will do the things that we command. So he's preparing you. And here, in verse 6, he tells you with the command. Now we command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you keep away from any brother with empty hands. Associates with some outsiders and some of his partners in ministry, and he included in a polite way, he says, we command you. But this was coming from the apostle himself. This was an apostolic command. He heart is because of the name of the name, which is Christ. It's not just like his own authority, it's like an authority of Christ himself, and he was appointed an apostle of it. And so Jesus was to give him through this church, and even us today. It's a strong call from Christ through his apostle for the church to separate themselves from the believer inside them. That word idol, I think, is better translated by the King James, which is just a little bit, or even the NASB, which is the unwilling. It carries the idea of a military sense. If you picture soldiers, maybe from North Korea or China, marching perfectly in line, it's the idea of one of those soldiers going out of rank against the best place to catch them. It's disorderly. It's disorderly conduct. Someone who lives irresponsibly. And notice he says that these people he's referring to are walking in idleness. This isn't just a one-off occasion. It's not just a slip-up. It's their general lifestyle, day to day, week to week. It's their habit. They are idle. And so what does he call the church to do? He says to keep the way out from you. Separation from me, or shrinking away from me, is the idea. He says, but we should associate with me, or follow the example, or even the influence of me. It's a serious call, isn't it? It's a serious charge to withhold close fellowship and friendship with this people. It's an act of loving discipline for the disorderly, idle behavior. But this wasn't something small. If you're one of those crazy sons, for the people. Remember, they had come out of an idol worshipping, pagan society, and many had been rejected by their families, their friends, for leaving their religion and their idol worship. They were cut off, and the church had become their new community. They loved each other, and that was spiritual family, and those bonds were deep. So what Paul was commanding the church to do was pretty significant. Of course, it's an exercise. It would cut deep. In fact, the very intention of it was to cause them to realize the seriousness of their actions, to reflect on the fact that they were rebelling against God, and to confess, and ultimately repent, and come back into line with God's word, to relationship. We need to understand a little more background here. In his first letter to the church, as I said probably a month earlier, Paul had instructed them concerning these very same kind of people. They weren't new on the scene. They'd been there right from the start of the church. He said in 1 Thessalonians 5:14, he's given an instruction on the church, to the church, and how to treat different corrections of Christians within the body. He says that we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with the idle. Admonish the idle or unbelieving is the exact difficulty. This is important to admonish or warn those who are unwilling or walking in willful disobedience to Christ's word, which would have included, of course, the once refusing. Well, now, in the second lesson, Paul takes it a step further. These ones who have refused to listen to the admonishments and the warnings from their brothers and sisters in Christ must now be separated from them. So, this is it. They haven't repented. Now, this is not meaning excommunication from church. Hopefully, that won't be needed. In fact, many commentators believe they still would have been allowed to come to public worship, or maybe would have been disallowed from participating in the love feasts that the church had, or even from the Lord's Supper communion, excluding from some of the life of the church's life. What's crucial, though, is that there's a social separation that these boring believers must feel because they ignore the warnings that God gave to them. They must not be trapped preaches like everything's normal and okay. He's sick and rebellious. That's the truth. We call the labor of how to be sick and wicked and idle as the second part of the piece, and not in accord with the tradition that you've received from us. Tradition refers to the authoritative teaching of the apostle, both when he was in person with him and in the moment his letter to the apostles in prison. They knew the difference, and they were disobeying him. They were marching out of range with the truth that had been given to him. In particular, disorderliness that came from was refusing to work as we see in the verses that follow. It's so interesting that Paul understood these lazy saints themselves. Paul addresses the culture, and he lays out their responsibilities for how to deal with his own unbelievers. But that is to fall on the elders of the church. He's not speaking to just the leaders, he's speaking to the entire body. The whole church is to have a part to play in helping these believers come to the place to God and life. So that's the first responsibility for the church, is to separate them from the unbelievers. And Paul goes on to establish why refusing to work was actually so serious. Contradicted the example that they themselves took in this social Silas and Timothy. They contradicted their example when they were there as the thermometer of humility among the believers. So Paul took responsibility to imitate godly examples. Verse 7. For you yourself, humility, how you ought to imitate us, because we were not idle when we were with you. These idle folk, these lazy Christians, they were not ignorant, they were not confused. They seemed full of Timothy and Silas as your example, day after day after day, when they were with him establishing the church. Paul says that their example was one of not being idle. They were their lifestyle was not marked by laziness or godlessness. They never went out of line with what they taught, with comfort and practice that they preached. And so it seems that the Thessalonians know how they ought to imitate them. There's a sense of obligation to follow in their footsteps. And Paul goes into even more detail with this verse about the godly example they gave in avoiding trouble. Nor did we beat anyone's drink without coming to it, but toil and labor. We worked night and day that we might not get the milk to be consumed. It's anyone's dream, but it's not just for having the old meal for somebody's house, but actually dependent on it to the basic needs. And while in Thessalonica, Paul didn't rely on Christians to get to the place, but rather he just had toil with labor day and night, which means full time. Simply with labor and technology, which is called strong. They would go around looking for handouts and free meals. But this word, toil, speaks of physical exertion. And the second carries the idea of struggle and strenuous toil, and working to complete exhaustion, like you might see someone finish a marathon in a place onto the ground. Their hard work, was motivated by the desire that they wouldn't be financially burdened to any Christian group. It would have been many in that church who were probably in the lower classes of society and not living in them to feed their own families. And now, they were even required or were asked to beg to feed the supply of saints too. Of course, we didn't require anything. We didn't want to be But their motivation wasn't just not to be a burden. They also worked with these verse 9 to give an example to the church to follow. It was not because we do not have the right, but to give you an example, that we set ourselves an example to imitate. Now, some wrongly service to listen, but Paul said that every worker that across the ministry takes the work for themselves. No. He says right here in the verse that it was not because we could, that it wasn't because we could not have the right to be supported by the churches. They did have that right. He was an apostle. And it wasn't the legitimate right to be supported by other Christians, by the churches who was ministering to them. Read 1 Corinthians 9, Paul argues extensively in that chapter about the right that they had. And he also teaches in his letters that this principle of the right of Christian workers to be supported for the laboring in the ministry extends to all of those laboring in Christian and teaching of the church. For example, 1 Timothy 5, 17 to 18, let the elders rejoice, be considered worthy of holy honor, especially those who labor in teaching and teaching. For the scripture says, we shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the ground, and the laborer deserves his wages. And in 1 Corinthians 5, 14, he says, in the same way, the Lord commanded those who proclaim the gospel to be better by the gospel. So do you see the contrast here of Christian Thessalonica? The very ones who actually didn't have a right to be supported were the very ones claiming that right and badgering and begging others to pay for their needs. But yet Paul and his companions who did have that legitimate right voluntarily put it aside. Not just to not be financially poor, but also to give them an example for themselves to the Christians to imitate. Now, in other churches, Paul was actually supported by those Philippians, and he did use that right. And even here in Thessalonica, he was given gifts from the church in Philippi, which helps to support their cause. But Paul sees in regard to speaking support from the Thessalonians themselves, while they were there, they willingly laid their rights aside. I think the reason is obvious. There were clearly some saints already idle in the church at this point who needed that apostolic example before their whole life to follow them. Yet they had it wrong. Our example is a powerful thing, isn't it? We have the potential to follow it, to cause other people watching us to do the right thing or the wrong thing. No matter how much you are, may the Lord help us to intentionally follow the examples of people who work and who labor with pure motives, and to be that example ourselves to others. With this team, we may not dimension the responsibility of what I've just said, but it's our need for not only to follow the example of godly examples, but to heed Christ's commands. Reaches his point that his people were clearly open to rebellion. Not only were they failing to imitate the example, but they were ignoring the direct teaching that they received from Paul. Look at this too. But even when we were with you, we would give you this command. If anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. If they could hear the seven commands in Christ, that those who are willing to work must not be allowed to eat. And the Greek tense used indicates that they meet not once, but over and over and over and over and over again, repeatedly. They weren't beaten up. They weren't confused about their need to work. They were choosing to ignore that command and lawfully disobey, which is why they just got to disobey the word or understand it. And the picture they heard was that if people refuse to work, don't provide for them, let them go hungry. Sounds pretty harsh, doesn't it, and deserves it. But they said that's what was commanded to them by the Lord. Laziness is not to be rewarded with food or support, but with the natural consequences, nothing. Now, let me make this clear. These are not people, remember, who aren't able to work. Because of whatever reason, their health, or disability, or no work is available, some other trick, not me, but they just can't work. These are ones that can work, should work, but want to work. Two, God has an obligation to provide and look after them. Of course, we must certainly, we certainly still have the responsibility to care for those global genuine things. Those who genuinely are related to work, whether elderly or from sick or disabled or the like. The other part is just making it very clear, like 1 Timothy 5, that God's structure isn't changed by. And we're called to look for providing for the raising of those who refuse. Let's just take a step back and look at the other thing. God's created work and his communication for it. Work itself, you see, is something that God has prepared. He built it up. That was even before Adam and his son. Genesis 1:15. The Lord took them in and put them in the Garden of Eden to do what? To work it and keep it. That's before the fall. So we think that humans were made with one of their purposes to work. It's a good thing. It's a God-given thing for human beings. And God himself works through it. He created the world in 6 days, and then he rested on the seventh. And he actively is working on sustaining the universe, redeeming, judging, preserving, and so on. But God himself sets the example for us to work. Of course, with sin coming into the world and God cursing creation, work for us has become toilsome. Painful and energy seeking, and has even lost some of that joy and fulfillment in the rest of the kingdom to heaven. Yes, even after the fall, that was still part of our responsibility. Even after sin, work was commanded by God. You may not realize, but it's in the 10 commandments at least, that God gave to the people of Israel through Moses. The 4th commandment says this, Exodus 20. 9 to 10. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the 7th day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. But Israel here were commanded to rest and keep the Sabbath on the 7th day, but also commanded to work the other 6 days. Psalm 104, verse 14 says, you caused the grass to grow for the livestock and plant for man to cultivate, that he may bring forth fruit for the earth. So you yourself that work is part of normal life. We work and we eat, which is what Paul taught to the Thessalonians. But work given in a sin cursed world as a gift from God. As God giving us the means of providing for our needs, finding satisfaction and using the bodies and strength and skills and the creativity that he's given us to glorify him through us, including in our attitude towards work and the manner in which we work, no matter how mundane the job that we have. Colossians 3:23-24, Paul reminds us that there isn't any part of our life that does not serve us and worship us. We have worked hard, even in our secular jobs, for this sake. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for man, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward, your servant, and your advice. So we don't know for sure the reason why some of us choose work refusing to work. Probably some of them would just be complacent, sluggish, that many problems to end up from becoming. Many commentators actually think that given Paul's teaching on the imminent return of Christ, that they would not apply it to our life and life, thinking that, well, if he's coming back to rapture us any moment, we might as well just stop working. His thought was, we need to start our drive to wait for Jesus to return. It's a possibility at all. And throughout history, it didn't increase. Even today, maybe it's not good. Possibly another thing that could be an influence of the culture that was around him. Remember, this church was mostly Gentiles or long-term people. And the Jews, they had a higher, more noble view of the world. Even the rabbis working had a trade alongside their teacher. However, the Greeks had a different view of work. They saw manual labor as something that's slave, but it's slave. Well, maybe these Christians had been influenced by the Greeks and they weren't renewing their thinking with God's truth. Whatever was causing them to do this, they were out of love and they were heeding the commands of Christ. Well, the final responsibility we'll consider today can be seen in this is a rhythm as well. This one is for the unworthy, the idle ones, themselves. To be summed up, deep to work. And here's the rhythm. Having shown the example of teaching well there, Paul explains to the folks that he can hear it, that it caused him to even need to spend the time in that person as a prophet so far. He says, for we hear that some among you walk in idleness, not busy at work, but busy grace. At this point, Paul was in southern Greece at Corinth, establishing the church there. And while he was there, he was still hearing constant reports of some in Thessalonica living this way. And here he identifies the specific way that they were idle, the specific manner of their unbelief. They were able to work, they were refusing to. They were active with their time. They were busy. But they weren't busy working by themselves. They were busy. Here's a lesson for us. We can be busy, but busy doing the wrong thing. The Romans were actually known to say that by doing nothing, meaning not to do nothing. It's a play on the words in the Greek language. That means it's simple, but busy. You're not busy working, but being busy. Working at everyone's business, not your own. Busybody is a very descriptive word. To be preoccupied with trifling things, to be intrusively busy, to be a peddler. The same word is used in 1 Timothy 5, verse 13, when Paul speaks of the danger of young widows not getting remarried. Besides that, they learn to be idlers, going about from house to house, and not only idlers, but gossips, also prophets, and busybodies, saying what they should not. So these are people who are going about and making a nuisance of themselves and just spewing from their mouths idle chatter, using their time the wrong way as busybodies. Forgetting that the affairs of others that is not their business. One commentator even implied that takes the most description of the great Christian. We may picture them sitting around for hours in the bazaars and the little shops of the other members with their fanatical notions, and returning home without money to buy the needed food, or appeal to other members to meet their needs and pester the leaders to provide them with money from the charity fund of the church. Coming to dream about that team busybody, is even familiar with tools, so as well as the universal problem that is failing to come. Today, I'm sure we can all think of people who go around actively causing disturbance through their work, hearing different people, possibly busy minding other people's business. Sadly, like in Thessalonica, they are the founder of churches too, with greatly stressing, of course, the purity and the divinity of Christ's body. going to continue to be the gospel towards Christ. I would urge you to continue to come to Jesus today. We'll come down to verse 12 with divine right to bring new commands to his people. It's good at the time when we're called here to obey God's desire for how we're supposed to. Now, such Christians with commands by power and will of Jesus Christ to do the word quietly and to do it together. These are serious messages. So that these to reach and test the authority again of Jesus himself. And although these are strength for Christians, they also teach it with love. He not only commands them, but he encourages them, he urges them. It's the picture of a general ordering the soldiers. At the same time, a father urging his children. It's a true, but a gracious appeal. Out of his concern and his love and his care for these things for his children. Can you imagine the same that they felt when this letter was opened and read and their sibling was born with him? What is it that he commanded them to do? To work quietly and earn their own living, which is knuckling down to the honest job of living in a way that doesn't cause everybody to meet them, with every life to meet them, for them, to provide for themselves, with this critical funding. These things stop irritating other Christians, and stop causing trouble, and confusion, and division in the church. Paul had months, or years ago, at this first, when he said, commander of these eyes of fire and lights to work as well. Look, when we have first this way, verses 10 to 12. He says, we urge you, brothers, to do this more and more, that is, to love one another. He says, it gets a river, and to fire, to live quietly, and to mind your own affairs, and to work with your hands, as we instructed you, so that you may look properly toward outsiders and be dependent on no one. They were pretty clear instructions with them. They've been told already to live quietly, to mind their own affairs, to work with their hands. Notice too that obviously the job is so that they walk in a proper manner as followers of Christ in the sight of unbelievers. They're not being dependent on people. You see, working hard rather than complaining is actually something history. Witness as Christians. Paul said this is first one of the five. If anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for members of his own household, he has denied his faith and his worth as an unbeliever. The biggest command is to share his sister. Now, some of you might be thinking this morning, this doesn't apply to me. I've got my work for some job. I think even our attitude towards them and how we go about working can be fulfilled by God's will. Sometimes we can be guilty of allowing just a little bit of laziness to creep into our work. It's when we know it's unwanted, right? This is a good reminder to think about work rightly, to make sure we're always working hard. Remember, in your workplace, you are representing Jesus Christ and that class, even in the manner that you work, the manner that you work. As parents, it's your responsibility to train your children to value hard work, something that's been lost, obviously, in our time, so that when they're old enough to think and embrace that and they have a bright biblical understanding of the work. I think although the context is simple, it's talking about those refusing to work for women, that the principles apply beyond that. God commands us to be also actively working in other areas of our lives outside of employment. In our families, we have different roles. Fathers, mothers, husbands, wives, children. Each with their own responsibilities at work. Do you get active and working hard in those things? Or are you a little bit apathetic and lazy and not really applying yourself to what God has called you to do something? We are ambassadors of Christ too. And part of that is that we are called to actively share the good news with people around us who are going to be lost in the next life. And to pray for those doorways and to pray for people's salvation. Again, I think these verses provide us an opportunity to pause and evaluate ourselves to consider whether we're active or not, or whether we're quiet and praying for what God has called us to do and witnessing for Him. We're also called to be good to everyone, showing the love of Christ not just in our words but for our actions. And what an amazing example of that yesterday, right? With some of you. Sacrifice your Saturday to go out to Easter, pick up souls and serve people who've lost everything to start from. That was labor of love. So I think it's a challenge for all of us. Are we working hard to be good to people? Then we're also called to give our spiritual giftedness to work each of our churches, not for ourselves, but for the common good. To serve other Christians in the body of Christ, whether that's helping practically, music, teaching, hospitality, making meals, making food, encouraging others, administration, praying for the needs of the saints, visiting people, whatever God's given you the ability to do, use it to serve Him by serving His people. And if you're actively doing that, I think these verses challenge us to reflect on those things. We all need to stop and reflect. Perhaps we're not idle like the ones called to wisdom, but we can all strive to be more active in all the securities God's called us to think on. Motivated with His faith, His faith and practice. Maybe some of you here are in the sense of what is trained, disobedient Christians, and you are choosing not to work when you're fully able to. You need to heed the words this morning of the Apostle Paul. And the message is clear. Stop being lazy and get to work. Well, we've seen already in Paul's words here four responsibilities we as the church have regarding faith itself. So that we get people working diligently, pleasing the Lord in that way as we wait for the return of His Son. Separating desire is the first. Communicating boldly, confidently, heeding Christ's commands, and getting to work. And next week we'll see three more responsibilities that God is going to wrap up on the day. In closing, we want to think rightly about the word as the good gift that God has given us. Remember that you may not enjoy your job. But even in the most mundane job, we are called to glorify and to serve God. We want to be busy working in the church, using our spiritual gifts to serve the body, doing the work of ministry, which is not just for the leaders of the church, but for all the saints who come by the way, building each other up. All of our labor, whether in a separate environment or not, whatever you do, for the glory of God. Amen. Well, let's turn to God for His help to lead these things in. Our Father in heaven, we come before you this morning. We thank you for how clear your word is about this church, about our need to work. And Lord, we, at this point, we just want to stop and consider the greatest work that was given to us in the history of the world, and network of the word on your side to all Jesus Christ, a combat cross, taking out some of the world. And so we thank you for that day, 2,000 years ago, when Christ did that work of salvation on our behalf. And we praise you, we thank you for what Christ has done for us. I pray that everything we do in our life will be motivated by the grace that you have already shown us here. And we would work with all of our hearts to give you the place for all that Christ has done to us. And we are presenting in this place this morning to thank you for the good life to Jesus Christ. I pray that they would do that with you. I pray that you would open their hearts to see their need for a Savior, to understand their rebellion against you, to understand the nature of Christ, and then to give them a standing of your righteousness. Thank you for your precious work.